Is that interesting again? How many of you made some shifts already that you're pleased with? Okay. And is there anybody who'd like some assistance in playing? Oh, great. Come on up. We need a... You always tangle this thing up for us. There we go. That? Either way, I don't care. You choose. You can leave this on the floor, I think. This is pretty long. There. Okay, tell me what you got.
What I got, my boundaries are like, kind of like hula hoops, or more like the old bathtubs. They had that shower curtain that went completely around that,
right.
The rail.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got a bunch of those.
Okay.
All right, some of them are different lengths. And,
yeah, and they're... Tell me more about them. So are they all up here like a shower thing? Or?
Yeah, pretty much, but it would start more around my neck or shoulder, and then they
down
go
here?
Out. They go out from there.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then does something drape down?
No.
It's just this bar?
It's just the bar.
And how does that protect you?
You know, I got the sense that it really doesn't.
I would think so.
it's just not very useful. But I tried working with it. I really I couldn't change it. I mean, I could get colors and do other things, and found that was interesting. But I really
and you have a whole bunch of these.
A whole bunch of these.
How many?
I get the sense of maybe 10, 15, but sometimes I have. I don't carry all of them with me. Some of them just will seem to appear when I need them.
Oh, I'd say that sounds like a good plan.
Yeah.
Okay, and they're mostly around like this.
Yeah.
And they go out how far?
I'd say the biggest one goes out maybe 25, 30 feet.
Okay.
But they don't go out from my back. That's the thing. In other words, they like start here and are out this way.
Right.
You know.
And that's actually fairly common. Usually we need less protection on our back. This is our vulnerable side, our belly and our face and so on. So it makes sense that it would go out farther on that way. Although it's nice to have a little protection back there, too, a little backup. Okay. Now, they must have some use. So, I mean, me just thinking about it and trying it on myself, I wouldn't think it would protect you very well, except against very large things, that they would kind of bump into it. But a lot of things could come underneath, smaller things and so on. In what way does that protect you? Like, think of a particular context where it'd be nice to have some protection and find out which one of these, what do we call these ring, hula hoops, which one of these hula hoops you would use in that situation and to what extent it does protect you, because that could give us some useful information about how to revise it or make some adjustments.
I guess they just determine the limits. I mean, you have different limits within different contexts, and so I know to be concerned if...
Okay, so it's like a marker.
Yeah, yeah.
So rather than being... It doesn't physically protect you, it just alerts you.
Yeah.
It's more like a signal system.
Yes.
Okay, good. Now, I think it's great to have a signal system, but I think it'd be nice to have some protection, too.
Okay.
Now, what could you use... You talked about the shower curtains hanging down. Now, I wouldn't think a shower curtain would do that much help, be that much help either, right? Because it's kind of flimsy.
Yeah.
But what if you had something hanging down from this hoop that was a little more substantial than a shower curtain? You'd probably want to see through it so that you could see what was out there.
Okay.
So just kind of play a little bit. And.
Okay. All right. Well, it makes it more interesting.
Yeah. Okay. How's that?
Well, it's...
You're always in the shower.
Yeah.
Now, when you say interesting, what is it?
Well,
can you say more about that?
Well, yeah, it changes it. In other words, I've got like this, I'll just describe it as mosquito net light, but it's more durable than a mosquito net.
So it's tougher than that?
Yeah, it's
give you some real protection?
Yeah. Yeah, okay. But I still get the sense that this is going to be hard to carry around.
Okay. Now, how else could you modify this?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, that's right. I don't have to carry it around that way.
No.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I could just eliminate those.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then what? Eliminate what then?
All the rods. I don't have to have those, the hoops or whatever.
Okay.
I don't need that anymore.
Okay. So what have you got now?
Well, I've just got this net light thing.
Okay.
Yeah, it's kind of
just
cool.
Around you. Is it only around your upper body?
No. This extends further down.
Okay.
Further down.
And does it come under your feet or?
No. It doesn't go all the way to the ground.
Okay. Experiment with that. How about if it goes all the way to the ground? Because your feet might need protection sometimes.
Yeah, I guess it would. If I put it out, I won't trip over it. So, yeah, that'll work.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And can you adjust the distance on this? In context, I mean. I mean, in a particular context, it might be fine to have it out fairly far. But in a different context, can you just kind of shrink it down?
Yeah. Yeah, okay. I can. That's cool.
Okay. Now test it in some other context. Try some other situations where you'd want to have some protection. Okay.
Yeah.
Work?
Yeah, works real well.
Okay. Now I'll bet there's more we can do.
Okay.
Play with it a little bit. Change its color. What would you call this thing now? The mosquito net.
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
The durable net.
The durable net.
The durable net,
okay.
Yeah.
Imagine some difficulty came in kind of from this side. Okay. Can you make it tougher on this side?
Yeah.
Can you do that?
Yeah.
Great.
Mm-hmm.
What color is it?
Well, I want to, for some reason, I just want to make it blue, and I'm having difficulty making it blue. It's more of a...
what is it now?
It's close to white, but it's not really white.
Close to white or off-white?
Off-white, yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You like it to be blue?
Yeah, I like blue.
Okay. Let's just see a little bit of blue down in one little edge of it and just watch it spread. Is it blue? Does it sound like that? You just made a sound. It's a nice tone.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Actually, I think I'd like it to be more invisible.
More visible.
More invisible.
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 Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Blue would be nice, but I think invisible would be.
Okay.
More get the sense
maybe
of
just
the
a little shimmering so you know it's
sure,
there. Because you want to know it's there, right?
That's and
you'd
right.
You'd like to have some idea of how far out it is and so on. Maybe just like a little shimmering, like a mirage.
Yeah.
Like hot, you know, hot air coming off of asphalt or something. So there's just that
very
little
good.
Shimmering.
Yeah, that's cool.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, how thick is it? How the boundary itself?
It's actually very thin, but it's very durable, so it'll work.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, that may be just fine, but I'd like you to experiment. What if you made it a little, you had just as much durability, but it was spread out in space a little bit, so that if something encountered it, you would have immediate notification. You'd have information right away, but it would still be kind of soft, and it'd kind of alert you a little bit.
Okay.
And then as it comes in farther, you get even more noticeable and so on.
I can see where that would be much more useful.
More analog.
Sure. Okay.
Now, there are times when a digital boundary is wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
In real danger, physical danger, you want to be able to respond instantly and all or none.
Mm-hmm.
You want 100%.
Sure.
But in most situations, an analog boundary works a little better. Mm-hmm. Someone comes in a little too close for comfort, and you kind of want to know about it, but you don't want to go, and, you know, have a freak out.
Sure.
So experiment with that a little bit. You know, try making it 6 inches thick. Just try that out, for instance. You're kind of fuzzy, and you'd still just see that little shimmery as your only.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah, you can do that.
Okay?
Yeah.
Now check it out in another context.
Okay.
Serve you well?
Yeah.
You don't want to go back to the bathroom?
No. No, I just updated, you know. That was an old time.
Yeah,
old stuff. Shag carpet and
You're modernizing your home, huh?
Yeah, that'll work.
Okay. Yeah. Is there anything else you want to play with?
No, that's fine. That's fine. I just want to enjoy this
for a while.
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
That's cool. Thank you very much.
Okay, you're quite welcome. Thanks. Okay, do you have any questions?
Yeah. Always like that.
I'm sorry, I forgot to. Come on back. I forgot to ask if anybody had any questions of you.
Sure.
Apologize.
So your boundary is the same in all contexts?
Well, I don't know. I haven't had a chance to try this on in all contexts, but I tried it on to several, so it works. So work. I tried it on at home. And at work, and I love to drive, so I tried it on, you know, making trips and things like that.
And they are all the same width?
No, it moves.
It's the same kind of...
It's the same type of net, but it can move. In other words, if I need it, in other words, if I were in a dangerous situation, it would go out further. If not, it could come in. So it's very...
Fabric.
Yes. Yeah. And it'll move.
And is it okay for you to just kind of relax the whole thing and let it go away as well?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's right.
Good.
Yeah. Very much so.
Okay.
Can you talk a little bit about permeability? Does it screen out everything, let some stuff in? How does that work?
Well, it doesn't screen out everything. I can see.
Right.
Yeah, could you be more specific?
Well, yeah, I was thinking even a scared situation you might be able to see, but I'm thinking maybe some of the auditory or the people's feelings you might want to keep out of the distance.
Yeah.
Or I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering about
it. Yeah. I hadn't really thought about that. There's nothing in this net that would keep me from seeing or hearing anything.
Okay.
Yeah.
What
so.
About the feeling part?
No.
So how does it serve to, does it protect you?
Yes.
And how does it do that?
It protects me by basically giving me information.
And how does it give you information? I'm sure that's good. That makes sense to me, but I'm just not interesting. How does it do it?
Yeah, it moves.
It moves?
Yeah. As it moves, I get a sense for what I need to do.
Okay, so it kind of alerts you?
Yeah.
It draws your attention in different directions and so on?
Yeah.
Kind of like early warning system?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And can you say any more about how it improves your functioning in a particular situation? Like pick a particular context. Let's say an interaction with some other person. And... having that boundary, what does it give you? What does it provide for you? How does it protect you?
What, just interacting with another person?
Mm-hmm. Or pick some other context if you want. That's just one that often people have difficulty with each other and communication problems and conflicts and so on. And for me, for instance, it sort of slows down time, so I have more time to react, more time to respond. When I have my boundary out there, it's like I'm in my own bubble here, and like things are going on out there, but I just have more time. I mean, it's probably hallucination, but my experience is, I got more time to respond. I don't have to get sort of tangled up in what's going on out there.
Okay.
I can observe it, get the information, and then kind of take my time in deciding, well, what am I going to do?
I like that. I'm getting, that's useful.
A little time bubble. Okay. Great. Well,
yeah.
See, I mean,
yeah.
See, you could interview, you could talk to 100 different people and get 100 different answers about how their boundary works, and maybe a bunch of it you'd know already from doing a bunch, but every once in a while somebody would come up with something you could add in.
Sure.
Add
yeah.
in.
That's cool.
So can you give me some idea about how this this it's now a shimmery boundary, right?
Mm-hmm.
How does that protect you? Pick any context, and if you're to the extent that you're willing and it's comfortable for you, give us a little detail. How does that differ? And, you can
okay.
test by just taking the boundary away
yeah. mm-hmm.
and then putting
okay.
it back, and what becomes different?
I think basically it just lets me have some idea about what the limits are. There are limits in every relationship or
mm-hmm.
situation, and it just kind of gives me something to measure
mm-hmm.
To know, how I should respond.
You have any other questions?
I have for you a question.
Okay. Any others for him? Okay, great. Thanks again.
Okay. Next time I'll try to do that.
That's called the muddle model, by the way. The muddle model? Can you be a bit more vague? Okay, you have a question for me.
Okay, you said that your boundary slows you down in a
uh-huh.
way that you don't have to rush in giving
mm-hmm.
an opinion or something.
Or response, yeah.
Response. But if the context needs to have a quick response,
uh-huh.
how would you...
Well, it's one of those things where every once in a while there's a movie about somebody who's running at a different time, a science fiction movie. And so things are going on out there, but things in here seem to be all slowed down. And there's this thing called time distortion. How many of you experienced in real life time distortion? Often in emergencies, in a car accident or something like that. It does exist. It's a little hard to get control of. Bandler has done some things to kind of do that. And basically, you slow down external time by speeding up yourself. That if you yourself are going very fast, then the rest of the world seems to slow down. And so it's not really that I'm taking longer in real time to respond. I can still respond quickly, but I have a sense internally of having more time. I've been married 3 times now, and I have an older son who's now in his 30s. And when he was about 4 years old, we were swimming in this river, and there was this eddy that was pretty safe, but somehow he got out into the current, and it was muddy, it was in springtime. And suddenly he lost his footing, and he was in deeper water, and his head would kind of bob down under the surface and then kind of bob up. And that's all I could see was his head bobbing up in this murky, very muddy water. And time slowed down way, way down for me. And I, did some quick calculations about what I needed to do and dived in and got him. And, it worked great. And very often people experience this in some kind of an emergency situation, is that time seems to slow down. Well, somehow inside you are speeding up. You're speeding up your calculations, but it seems like events are slowing down. And that's the kind of thing I'm talking about. That if you can find some kind of anchor, like some kind of the color or sound or shape of the bubble or that's around you or something, that can give you that sense of having more time. It's not really that you're slowing down, okay?
I think it gives a sense of wisdom or I don't know how to say it, but I found in that sort of situation, it gives you time to respond rather than react.
Yes.
You have a choice.
Exactly, yeah.
It's a place of
yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Another way of saying that is that the response involves choice, whereas reaction is just automatic mousetrap kind of thing where you trigger the thing and bam, like that.
So is that what you mean by it should protect you when you talk about toughening it up on one side or another? I'm not really connecting with that metaphor because it comes down to, as in your case with your son, your action.
Well, it's somehow that it's very metaphoric, so it's kind of hard to explain in little fine detail, which frustrates me because you know by now that I really like to be able to slice things really small and get very, very specific about exactly what to do. But somehow the image of having it toughen up on one side means that I have more time. And since I have more time, I can think through some alternatives, and I might do it very quickly, but it feels like I have more time, and as Anne says, it's more like a choice response rather than an instant reaction, which may not be the best thing to do. It's very metaphoric, but it's very, very powerful. I've got some examples in the book that you guys can read later, but it really does change people's behavior in a situation. And automatically. It's like you become different. So it is part of your self-concept. It's part of how you respond. And so you can make these adjustments. Have you thought of some other situations? Just think of another one now. And you got this shimmery bubble around you. About 6 inches thick now? Okay. Somehow it makes something easier to deal with. That rather than being, jerked by your neck into some situation and floundering or something like that, that somehow you have time or you have space or you have something. It gives you some kind of protection so you have more resources, more ability to respond in a variety of ways. Rick's trying this out now. That help answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, great. It's just stuff in your mind. I mean, there's nothing really here, right? But somehow this is one of the things that we've learned to do, that we all do it in some way, so why not do it the best way possible? Total hallucination. But it makes a difference. I mean, all this stuff that we've been dealing with the last 2 days about building databases and all this stuff, it's also crazy. But it's crazy stuff that works. It's all maps. Anything else? Is there anybody else who'd like to play with adjusting something that's not quite as satisfactory as they'd like to have?
I don't have some of the basic information. There are a couple things running through my head that I'm... One is sometimes... I feel like I'm, and this is a self-concept thing, it just dawned on me, I'm overly responsible. And sometimes I think that has to do with the way I have or don't have a boundary, but I don't have any idea about that.
Want to come play?
Yeah. I don't know if I'll, yes, okay. I'll try.
Yeah, this is a good thing. I'd like to play with this. So. So you've played with your boundary. Tell me a little bit about your boundary.
Well, I really don't have much of a sense of it, actually.
Okay.
I don't have. That's why I hesitated to volunteer, because I don't have much detail about it.
Okay. Well, you saw what we built for Jim.
Right, yeah.
Does that something like that appeal to you a little?
Yes, it does, yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Try out something like that.
Okay.
Kind of force field, the force fields from science fiction?
Where yeah.
Somebody comes too close and kind of sort of goes like
yeah.
that.
I think my first impression is there's a field that emanates from me.
Okay.
And it would be a more of an analogical
okay.
thing so
that
they could come degrades. Yeah.
Right.
And I would have
it's almost like I condense it up a little bit.
Great.
So that they can only come so far. I can make it more dense.
Okay.
So that they only can come so near.
Right. You just turn up the gain on the...
Yeah, or I can loosen it up so that they can come all the way in, too.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Sure.
Okay.
Great. And does it extend around behind you as well? I'd suggest that.
I think that's a good idea, too. Yeah, I'd
like
it to
be. Doesn't have
to
go out so far behind, probably.
Right.
So it kind of envelops you.
Right.
More or less egg shape or something like that?
Yeah, or, oval, yeah.
Okay, Okay. Now, can you think of someone you don't feel responsible for? Someone with whom you can be and not have any sense of responsibility for them.
Someone I'm in relationship with?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or,
or someone who's around. Just anybody.
Okay.
Okay.
Almost as soon as I know someone, there's something, though, about that, I think. I begin to feel responsible in some way, probably.
Okay. How would you feel responsible, for instance? What kind of things would you do? Trying to make them feel good? Or?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. That would be probably right at the top of the list.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, how about somebody you don't know?
Okay. Just someone walking down the street.
Yeah. You feel responsible for them?
Mm-mm.
Okay. So this can be a target goal. If you want to not feel responsible, that experience of someone just walking by,
mm-hmm.
and you don't know who they are,
right?
And you don't feel any pull or any motivation to make them feel good.
Right.
I'm sure you don't wish them ill or anything, but it's just neutral, right?
Right.
Okay. So that can be kind of something to memorize a little bit, that this could be a choice to add in to people that you do know.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, take a moment to keep your eyes closed and notice how you visualize this. Here's somebody just walking down the street,
mm-hmm.
and where's your boundary? What is it like? And beyond boundary, we don't have to restrict ourselves to boundary, but what is it like just seeing this person go by?
Mm-hmm.
And then contrast that with someone you are in relationship with where you do feel a pull to make them feel good or take responsibility for them.
And I'm going to use an energy metaphor here.
Sure.
The energetic exchange with that person is... almost nil.
Okay.
There's no...
The person walking by.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Right.
Yeah. There's just air between you and nothing else, right?
Yeah, there's very little energetic exchange between me and them.
Right.
There's just like...
okay.
It's detachment.
Okay.
Would be the negative, or the negative way of saying that. There's no connection.
Yeah. Okay. Now think of someone you're in relationship with, and you gesture toward this point on your upper chest.
Mm-hmm.
Is there something there that kind of...
That connects to them, sure there is, yeah.
Okay. How would you describe that?
There's a very strong energetic connection, depending upon who they are, of course.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Right.
Okay, just pick one person that you do have a connection with.
Okay, I think of my daughter. Okay.
And how would you describe the connection there between you and that other person? Does it go chest to chest? Or?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. And it's as you gestured, I guess it's fairly narrow. How big around is this connection, this energy connection?
Let's see. I don't know, maybe like like this.
Okay. 10 or 12 inches across. Mm-hmm. Okay, and then you're gesturing a little lower now.
Yeah, let's see.
Oh, fairly high? Okay,
well,
still
I don't know.
Chest.
Somewhere in here.
Okay, great. Now, what if you just experiment, mm-hmm. and what if you narrow that down a little bit? What happens?
There's less feeling involved.
Is that a little less connection then? Less energy exchange?
I think so.
Okay. So this could be a way to adjust if you feel over responsible or over connected,
mm-hmm.
that you could simply adjust the diameter of that.
Yeah.
No, oh, you got some tears coming. What's that about?
Mm-hmm. Well, this is heart stuff too, I guess so.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
What are the tears about?
I think this is a powerful thing for me.
Uh-huh. Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
And so, is it, I'd like to understand your tears better.
Okay.
Is it tears about how important this connection
mm-hmm.
is with your daughter?
Yeah.
And you don't want to narrow it?
Actually, it could, I'm not sure.
Well,
it could
close
be,
your
it,
eyes.
It could be okay to be narrowed or narrower.
Just explore this a little bit.
Okay.
Because tears are a very strong sign of something very important to you. And I think it could be useful for me to understand it, and I think also for you.
Mm-hmm.
Because it could mean many different things. It could be simply realizing the strength and of the importance of this connection with your daughter. It could be some, I mean, I'm just going to offer possibilities, and of course, my brain is limited, so you can think of other possibilities. It could be, for instance, that when you narrow the energy flow, there's a sense of release or from the responsibility,
mm-hmm.
and sort of releasing your daughter into the world a little bit, which could also be a source of tears. I don't know.
It's not about releasing her. That's not where the tears are coming from, I don't think.
Mm-hmm. Fine.
It's like the energy from here moves immediately up here somehow. There's an energy flow this way.
Okay, so it flows up into your head.
Mm-hmm.
And then does it go out to the other person?
Or
does some of the energy that used to go out to the other person go up into your head?
It starts here and goes here, and then it goes into my eyes, and I tear up. So, let's see, how do I do that? How does that happen? Let me see if I can. I can think of certain experiences. And that immediately comes here and goes here and then up here.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The experiences that touch you in some way.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. Great.
Mm-hmm. And if I wanted it to be less, if I constricted this a little bit, that does make a difference.
Okay. And how does it make a difference?
It's less feeling.
Get less feeling if you constrict it. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Then what if you expand it?
It's more.
Then you get more.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this is a way that you can have some choice about how much you to express in any given situation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this isn't with her. This can be with, you know, lots of, I mean, just
sure.
I just randomly picked her because she's...
Okay. Well, I don't think it's quite random.
No,
but
it's
I understand
not random,
that
but
it's
I
more
want to
than
pick someone
her.
That I have some connection with, yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nice. But I have the same phenomenon in other lots of other situations, actually.
Okay.
So it'd be nice to have a little more choice about it.
Uh-huh. Right. I'm always for choice.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, you started by coming up here and talking about being overly responsible.
Yeah.
Or something. Uh-huh. I forget the exact words, but...
Yeah.
Now, are we talking about the same thing here with the tears and the energy connection, or is that a separate kind of a different aspect of this?
I think it might be a slightly different aspect.
I would think so, too.
Yeah.
That,
I don't think it's the same.
Now, can you think of some situation in which being over-responsible with your daughter, for instance, or someone else if you want to pick, gets in their way?
Hmm. Let's see.
In other words, it's somehow a difficulty for them as well. Or is it
you
only
know,
for you?
It's only. I think it's mostly for me.
Okay.
They may not even know that I feel responsible.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. You know, I think I, my guess is I somehow take on, they tell me something,
mm-hmm.
or something happens,
mm-hmm.
and I take on having to do something about it.
You must fix it.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is a guy thing.
Yes, it is a big guy thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Right, yeah.
Okay.
And I'm better about it now than I used to be, but it's still a big thing.
Okay,
you
know? Got it.
So someone, a secretary comes to me and says something about something going on in our staff, and uh-huh. I think, well, she's telling me that because she wants me to do something, and then I immediately feel responsible to
yeah.
do something. And I, you know.
Right. Okay. Now, how could we use this boundary to give you some separation from this? So that, for instance, if you had this boundary, just as Jim had a boundary that kind of gave him additional choice,
uh-huh.
what if we had some kind of boundary so that if Anwar were to come to you and say, you know, oh, there's a problem, so and so, such and such, that you wouldn't feel that immediate pull to fix? And just explore a little bit, because
mm-hmm.
you know these are very personal things. It's
yeah.
very different for different people. But something that would give you a little bit of choice, a little bit of separation, a little bit of time, a little bit of distance. And I think you would still want to have the choice to feel that energy connection.
Right.
But maybe some control over it.
Mm-hmm.
Some choice about how much, when.
Right.
And just explore. Let me just try something and
that's great.
Offer you something to
Good.
Try. Imagine that your daughter or your wife or somebody or your secretary says something and you, one of those contexts.
Mm-hmm.
And you use that context to play and test,
mm-hmm.
okay? And initially make a very, very rigid boundary. Well, not necessarily rigid, but very complete.
Okay.
So that you can hear the words, but nothing else.
Okay.
And just explore what that's like. I don't think this is our end goal, but I think it
yeah.
might be a useful beginning place.
Mm-hmm.
So that it's almost as if they're a stranger passing on the street.
Mm.
This is just experimenting now. I'm not,
yeah.
I'm not setting this up as an ultimate goal.
Yeah.
So it's like a stranger on the street is walking by, and then they turn to you and they say so-and-so, such-and-such.
They're probably, you know, this, Covey has this circle of influence and circle of concern thing. It's almost like they're, a stranger saying something is, and it depends. If probably if I have a heart connection with them, I would take that much more seriously.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Or if they were talking about a situation that I had experienced personally,
mm-hmm.
I would take it more serious. I might take it more responsibly or mm-hmm. whatever, however I do that.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. Review what you're asking me to do, Steve. I'm sort of
well,
lost.
Well, okay, sure. That's fine. I want to explore an extreme.
Okay.
I mean, you've talked about this heart connection in which you immediately have this urge to do something.
Right.
Right? And then you have the very strong feelings and so on.
Right.
I don't want to explore the opposite extreme.
Let me give you a real specific example.
Okay.
This happened 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So I work at a church, and we had a pastor that was causing lots of havoc in the mm-hmm. community. He mm-hmm. was new, and the secretary at the time was someone I had known for a while. We had been friends before she came to work here.
Mm-hmm.
And she would come to me and say, this is going on, mm-hmm. or that's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And it always felt like a burden to me.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Like, so?
Yeah.
But I don't just say so. I say, yeah, now what am I going to do about that?
Right, right. So what I want to explore, let's take this situation.
Okay.
And what I want to explore is the opposite of what you do. Not okay. as an end goal, but as a learning piece.
Okay.
And see what you
can
learn.
So just sort of blow it off.
Not quite. No, not quite that far.
Okay.
I keep wanting to use the stranger on the street thing. That you could have compassion for the stranger on the street, that he has some difficulty and so on.
Right.
But it's his problem.
Right.
So it's not that you're blowing it off and saying, it doesn't matter.
Right.
But it doesn't matter to you, it matters to him. And you can have some sense of it mattering to him, that other person.
Right.
And have goodwill toward that person.
Right.
But there's somehow some kind of separation. And I would, given that we're talking with boundaries, I would use some kind of boundary as a separation. That you have
spatially
some kind of
or some way.
Plexiglass or energy boundary or something like that, so that that's happening over there
mm-hmm.
and it doesn't happen to you.
Let's see, yeah.
You do that?
Let's see, how do I do that?
One of the things I'm going after here is to separate your caring for someone else with your need to fix them or
mm-hmm.
offer something.
Right.
Because sometimes the best way of caring for someone else
is
to leave them on their own.
Yeah.
And have them do their own learning or their own discovery
mm-hmm.
and so on.
Yeah.
That it can be a burden for the other person, too, to be always helping.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
You know, and I can do that with people. I mean, you know, I have clients that I do that with. You know, I don't carry their stuff. I work with them, and while we're working, I'm engaged and
right.
helpful and all
okay.
that. And then when they leave the office, you know, I think, you know, they're going to go on with their life, and
okay.
I'm
going
to go on with my life.
Now, what allows you to do that? Be with a client in your office. What kind of boundary do you have?
I think it's a temporary thing.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a way in which I temporarily do this,
mm-hmm.
and when they leave, then there's a letting go of it somehow.
Okay, and what is it you do with them?
When I let go?
No, what before you let go.
Okay, while I'm working with them?
Uh-huh. Do you feel a burden of responsibility? Or are you just there to be offer your skills?
Uh, that varies too. Some people I do feel a burden of responsibility.
Okay, let's go for the other.
Okay.
Go for somebody that...
That just this skill.
Yeah,
whatever
you're
you're a resource to them.
You're a resource to them. You're offering your skills, but you don't feel burdened. How do you do that? And you can always compare. You think of another client that you do feel burdened. What's
mm-hmm.
different in your imagination? You pick those two situations, contrast them. Are the submodalities different?